Tiffany, I want to start with Palo Alto Networks and get your thoughts there, because we're seeing shares down a little more than 4% as we speak. The company did report disappointing earnings outlook, but Fortinet and Checkpoint posted strong results. What's going on with Palo Alto?
I think across the cybersecurity space, we are seeing pretty strong trends. The last couple of quarters, we saw some customer rationalization of spending. I think we're seeing that coming to an end, and we're starting to see sales growth pick up again. Palo Alto obviously down today. For the most part, the metrics were pretty good that they reported. Some of the key metrics that investors look at, like recurring revenue, was very strong in the quarter, and they beat numbers for the most recent quarter that they provided. However, free cash flow guidance looks like it's a little bit second half loaded for the year, which I think is disappointing some people. But I would say I think the other important thing that we're positive on is that over the last couple of quarters, Palo Alto has adopted a platform approach to product sales, which seems to be resonating with customers. And I think we saw more evidence of that this quarter. And this helps customers consolidate spending, which is a trend that we've seen for the last couple of quarters. But I also think for the longer term, the trend of increasing cyber threats is not slowing down. And Palo Alto will play an important role in helping their companies and their customers secure their data and also their AI models, because we are seeing companies face traditional security threats such as data breaches, but new threats driven by AI, such as, you know, more sophisticated threats or enhanced security threats that are designed to disrupt output for an AI model.
Tiffany, let's stick with AI. In particular, some of the big tech giants that have made some pretty wide comments about infrastructure, R&D, talent investments. How discerning are investors when it comes to this kind of spend? Do they care where it's going, especially now off the news that Meta is building a humanoid robot, which is surely to take quite a bit of investment there?
Yeah, I think investors are definitely keeping a very close eye on the amount of spending that the large companies like the hyperscalers are putting into AI. And over the course of the next couple quarters, we're going to want to see returns on those investments. For the cloud providers specifically, they're spending a significant amount of CapEx and investing in AI processing capacity, I think, in order to stay ahead of trends. Amazon's CEO Jeff Bezos said recently that he thinks that we'll see a world where virtually every app has generative AI in it, and they need to invest to stay ahead of this. So the cloud providers are offering a variety of AI models, which are pre-trained for use cases, but they also help customers tune a model or adapt it to specific needs. And they're also offering tools and services like secure data storage and data management that make it easier for their customers to handle the large data sets required for AI models. And I think that all of these services should see additional demand with faster adoption of AI. And I think what we'll see is these companies are becoming kind of the toll roads for AI, where they're supplying the cloud, the tools, some of the developers, and the processing capacity that their customers need to enable other companies to develop and deploy AI.
We've also seen some comments coming from Washington that the government plans to be more supportive when it comes to investments in artificial intelligence. How much of that initial enthusiasm from President Trump's Stargate venture being announced has worn off by now?
I think that that's probably the Stargate venture is a flashy announcement, but I think it's more of the same of what we're seeing. There was already a significant amount of capital investment going into infrastructure spending, formalizing announcements, with multiple companies investing is a great news story and maybe accelerate some of the spending. But I think a lot of the spending was going to happen anyways over the next 3 to 4 years and over the next decade.
Are you not at all concerned about CapEx spending from the hyperscalers, from any members of the Mag 7 being too much? Are they overspending?
I don't think they're overspending right now. A lot of the spending from the Mag 7 companies is going to their own use cases where they're actually seeing a return on those investments in terms of better advertising models or better offerings to customers. But a lot of the spending is also going to support their customers who are trying to develop AI tools that they're going to sell in the future. So I don't think that I wouldn't call it overspending at this point. And I do think that the adoption curve for AI is probably going to pick up very significantly from here, as we do see costs coming down very significantly. And that's going to fuel more demand for the services that the cloud providers are providing.
Well, speaking of costs coming down, the news that we got from DeepSeek a little over 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago at this point, does that mean that indeed these companies have become more efficient when they're training LLMs, for example, that they won't need all the CapEx that's been invested?
That's definitely a concern in the market, and you saw that in the Monday after the DeepSeek R1 model announcement. I don't think that we're going to... I think what we're seeing is that the DeepSeek announcement was really highlighted the efficiency of model development already. So costs for model development from the established U.S. players like OpenAI or Anthropic have been coming down almost as quickly as we saw in the DeepSeek model. So I think it's really highlighted how efficient the models are becoming, how fast the technology improvement is. And if we need less processing power per computation or per inferencing instance, I don't think that leads to a lesser demand for processing capacity. I think that means that adoption picks up faster. So if you think about, the adoption of cell phones as they got cheaper, more people bought them, you didn't end up needing to make less cell phones.